Good morning. Aren't you glad you're here?
Amen.
Wouldn't you rather be here than in the best jail in Carlsbad? Wouldn't you rather be here than out fighting a great white shark off the coast in Carlsbad? Well, we're delighted that you're here this morning. It's a wonderful morning. We're in May gray, which gives way to June gloom, and then July fry.
Yeah.
So we're going to have a wonderful service this morning. It is Trinity Sunday. It's the kickoff to what's called ordinary time, or what this year we're going to call extraordinary time. We're going to have some really great services about what it means to know Jesus. Did anybody see any signs this morning on your way in? Last week we hired the pastor of evangelism, and he got to work right away. We got some know Jesus signs, because as you'll see, we're going to be talking about what it means to know Jesus. So we're not going to be having conversations about God this summer. We're going to be hopefully introducing people to the experience of who Jesus is and how he dramatically transforms our life when we give the Holy Spirit the opportunity to do that. So for those of you who are new to the congregation, the center section is reserved for people who are completely vaccinated, and you can feel free to unmask, show your pretty or handsome faces, and you will be fine. There's almost zero chance you're going to get sick around people who are fully vaccinated, so please feel free to do that. If you're in the process of being vaccinated, if you could use the wings, that would be great, but you can get really close, so you don't have to feel like you have to sit way back in the corners or something like that. We're hopefully really friendly about that kind of thing. Just ask that if you're not fully vaccinated and you want to have conversations, just please use your mask while you do that, and we should be just fine. In a few more weeks, hopefully, we won't have to worry about this at all for at least 8 months to a year, until we all have to go and get boosted. So that'll be great. So Trinity Sunday. How many of you have had a really clear understanding of the Trinity and you can describe it perfectly? How many of you have tried to think about the Trinity just before you've gone to sleep at night? How many of you slept that night? Yeah, one of the great church fathers said, never try to understand the Trinity when you sleep, lest you may never. So today we're going to talk about the Trinity from a biblical perspective as a way of introducing what it means to know Jesus. So I don't think there's any better song to sing than this beautiful hymn by Reginald Heber, written in the 1700s. Holy, holy, holy. Let's stand together as the cross enters and we're reminded that Jesus is present among us. God bless you as you worship.
Oh,
Hallelujah. God is among us.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah. We gather to worship because we want to know Jesus. Like those who came to Jesus when he was here on earth, we want to know Jesus. Let's pray together, Father, right now. I open my heart, my desires, and my secrets that you may know me. I hide nothing from you. Cleanse my thoughts and intents. Undo my stubborn will and inspire me by your Holy Spirit to more perfectly love you and make your holy name great through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, brother and friend. Amen. You may be seated during this song. It's a song by the Newsboys called We Believe, and it's a kind of a creative way of thinking about confessing our faith in Christ. If you know the song, sing out. If you play air guitar, play.
In this time of desperation, when all we know is doubt and fear, there is only one foundation. We believe, we believe. In this broken generation, dark, you help us see. There is only one salvation. We believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and he's given us new life. We believe in the crucifixion. We believe that he conquered death. We believe in the resurrection, and he's coming back again. We believe. So let our faith be more than anthems, greater than the songs we sing. And in our weakness and temptations,
yeah.
Our scripture readers, if you'll start coming forward, today's scriptures speak to us as the Holy Spirit helps them come alive in us. So let's open our hearts and minds to hear God's word and be transformed by it. Our first passage this morning is from Exodus chapter 3, verses 1 to 6, and it shows us that God is a loving Father, a Father of fathers.
Exodus 3, verses 1 through 6. Now Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law, Jethro, the priest of Midian, and he led his flock to the west side of the wilderness and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. He looked, and behold, the bush was burning, yet it was not consumed. And Moses said, I will turn aside to see this great sight, why the bush is not burning. When the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called him out of the bush, Moses, Moses. And he said, here I am. Then he said, do not come near. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground. And he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 93 proclaims the one true God is Lord, creator and sustainer of all that is.
The Lord reigns. He is robed in majesty. The Lord is robed. He has put on strength as his belt. Yes, the world is established. He shall never be moved.
Your throne is established from of old. You are from everlasting.
The floods have lifted up, O Lord. The floods have lifted up their voice. The floods have lifted up their roaring.
Mightier than the thunders of many waters, mightier than the waves of the sea, the Lord on high is mighty.
Your decrees are very trustworthy. Holiness befits your house, O Lord, forevermore.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
In Romans 8, 12 to 17, St. Paul reminds us that the Holy Spirit's work in us gives us our legacy of relationship to the Trinity.
So then, brothers, we are debtors, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs to God and fellow heirs with Christ, provided we suffer with him in order that we may also be glorified with him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Longing for peace, our world is troubled.
John chapter 3, verses 1 to 16 records the transforming encounter of a sincere seeker with Jesus about what it is to be saved. The holy gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Now, there was a man from the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. This man came to Jesus by night and said to him, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher come from God, for no one can do these signs that you do unless God is with him." Jesus answered him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Nicodemus said to him, "How can a man be born when he is old? Can he enter a second time into his mother's womb and be born?" Jesus answered, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and of the Spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. That which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. Do not marvel that what I said to you, you must be born again. The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Nicodemus said to him, "How can these things be?" Jesus answered him, "Are you the teacher of Israel, and yet you do not understand these things? Truly, truly, I say to you, we speak of what we know and bear witness to what we have seen, but you do not receive our testimony. I've told you earthly things, and you do not believe. How can you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except he who descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life." But you can probably say this with me: "For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
to you, Lord Christ. Longing for food, many are hungry. Longing for water, many still thirst. Make us your bread, broken for others, shared until all are fed.
So today we start a new series, Know Jesus. How do you like it? Do you like the title?
No.
Know Jesus. Well, that's kind of the way the world thinks about it, right? There's the world over there on the right-hand bottom side of the screen, Know Jesus. But we've been talking about the incarnation all year. So somehow we have to change it.
Wow.
Oh, wait a minute. I must have gotten the wrong slide. So we want to talk about Know Jesus, because once you know Jesus, you say the magic prayer and or take communion and you're done, right? Nothing more to know. Do you like the title now? I mean, it is better than N-O Jesus, right? Know Jesus. But I don't know. Gene, are you switching the slides on me this morning? No, I'm not. Just knowing Jesus. What about if we talk about knowing Jesus? In other words, an ongoing process of letting the Holy Spirit so transform us that we admit, "I don't know it all," after I say my prayer of confession. "I don't know it all," no matter how many times I take a wafer and drink some wine. In fact, I can always learn something new about Jesus. And I always wait until Sunday to do that. And everybody said,
"Not a good idea."
Chip goes, I agree. No, how do we know Jesus? Well, Anglicans have a great opportunity. Because way back in the 1500s, a guy named Thomas Cranmer said, you know, if we're ever going to make disciples of common people, we need to make sure that they have their common language so that they can read it. So he encouraged people to translate Latin Bibles into English words. And guess what happened? They killed him. Muriel didn't know that until just now. They killed him. And 3 years later, the very same Bible that he had translated was authorized by the king to be read in every Anglican church. In the meantime, the guy who died advocating that the Bible be translated into English wrote a companion book. And what do you think he called it? The Book of Common Prayer. Did he write it in Latin? No. He wrote it in English. With these two books, you can do two things especially. Number one, you can be a disciple of Jesus. You can read the scriptures. You can read a little bit of commentary on the scriptures. Even if you have the Book of Common Prayer, you can do a lot of scripture reading. It guides you through praying five times a day. I know some people have said, wow, Muslims must be very devout reading five times a day. Anglicans have been doing this for over 500 years. And what else? Well, not only are you able to be a disciple, you're able to take these two books and establish churches everywhere. In other words, if you're a student in high school, you can talk to your friends. If you have colleagues at work, you can have a noon Bible study. You can do all of this with just these two books. Two incredible tools for doing one thing, knowing Jesus. You know, in English, the reason we put that ing on the form of words is so that it expresses continuity, so that there's a sense of process in the fact that what you're looking at is really never done. So thank you for coming here this morning, but you could have learned a whole lot more during the course of this week had you been reading your Bible and reading through what's called the daily office or daily devotions. Then you would come here on Sunday morning and you wouldn't even have to crack your Bible. We'd do these readings and you'd be going, yeah. Know that? Yeah, got it. Nailed it. No problem. I know what he's going to say. Then you'd be putting us out of business. And everybody said, no. Don't say that. Okay, so let's talk about the question. What is knowing Jesus? And why does it really matter? So this is Trinity Sunday, and there's a Trinity window from Petropolis. And on that window, you can see there's what looks like the hand of God, and then there's a dove, and then there's an infant. And you recognize those as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. In fact, that's exactly right. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. This is the triunity. Now, I'm not going to try to describe the Trinity in Euclidean geometry this morning. I'm not going to use different, like, water, ice, and mist as an illustration. I'm not going to bring a giant three-leaf clover. I'm not going to try to do that, but I am going to give you intimations of the Trinity that we find in the scriptures just so that you know that the truth is there. Sometimes this is shortened to call the Trinity rather than the triunity. God in three persons. You sang it this morning, Blessed Trinity. The bottom line is that we begin to know Jesus by knowing the Trinity. Today's scriptures are going to help us know the Trinity as the Lord God, the one Lord God, the loving Father, the saving Son, and a legacy of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit who lives in us every day, what he teaches us, how he transforms us, and then hopefully what can happen as we go out in the world and are totally on fire, well, hair on fire, like last week, for Jesus Christ. How did you like our signs this morning?
Yeah.
knowing God. That's really what we're all about. So let's know a little bit more about God. If you want to take some notes, please go right ahead. The passage this morning from Psalms introduces it, and it says, the Lord reigns, he is robed in majesty. He's put on the strength of his belt. The world is established, it shall never be moved. Your throne is established from of old, you are from everlasting. The Lord on high is mighty, your decrees are very trustworthy. What's that? Well, that's really a summary of the verses all together so that we can learn a little bit more about the one Lord God. So the Lord here is not the word for the great distant God, El. The word here is Jehovah, Yahweh. And do you know what it means? The one who comes close, the one who is imminent, the one who you can embrace, the one who loves you. The one who loves you reigns. He is king and sovereign. He is robed. That gives him, in those ancient cultures, authority and glory. He has belt strength. Do you know what that means? The word that's used here in Hebrew is of a piece of clothing that binds everything together. Guys may not know so much about this, but maybe ladies do. Things that kind of draw you in and make you look more like you think you ought to look. Well, that's what this word is. Belt strength is, it ties everything together so that it's a unity. He's the establisher of the world and the throne. It means he is omnipresent. From old, from everlasting. That means before, but it also means eternal. He is mighty. He is omnipotent, all-powerful. He has very trustworthy decrees. Not just trustworthy decrees, very trustworthy, which means his decrees are like no other. And that means he is omniscient. This is our Lord who draws near to us, our one God who loves us and cares for us. That's the overarching understanding of God, or sometimes what's called the Godhead. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4. But also an intimation of the Trinity. Let us make man in our image. Let us make man in our image. One God, but the intimation of more than one person in the Old Testament. Genesis 1:26. So what do we know from this passage? Well, two things especially. God shows himself. He is not silent. He speaks. He's involved. He makes himself known. And he does that imminently. He is here. When we bring the cross in on Sunday, we're not bringing God into this place. He's already here. We're reminding ourselves of his presence among us. But the second thing we know is that we can draw close and know God. How? Intimately. Because he is imminent, we can be intimate with him. So when you walk into a sanctuary like this, do you get a sense? Does something happen in your heart? When you get up in the morning and say, good morning, Lord, as opposed to good Lord, it's morning. Good morning, Lord. Do you get a sense in your heart that you're about ready to spend the next 12, 14, 16, 18 hours in the presence of the one who created the cosmos and continues to sustain it by his powerful word? The one who is involved with you and is never apart from you? Do you get that sense? Do you get that sense that he's there in the middle of your successful parts of your day? Or do you wait until there's a crisis and go, oh God, help? Maybe during those successes, thanks God, I really appreciate the way things are going this morning. All right, so there's the Godhead. Now, what if we start talking about the persons? Well, let's talk about the loving Father. I am the God of your father. It almost sounds like, I hate to say it this way, but Darth Vader, Luke, I am your father. So, but think about this. I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Who was God saying to Moses, I am the God of your father? Essentially, he was saying, I'm the father of your fathers. And then he starts mentioning names, not only identifying himself as the I am, and God himself, the authority, the one to whom we ought to ascribe all honor and glory. But he says, I am the God of your fathers. In other words, there's a binding power that's taking place here. There's a link. And the first one that gets mentioned is Abraham. Now, Abram in Babylonian means outstanding. What did Abraham need more than to be outstanding in his culture? He was about 75 years of age. God gave him a new name, Abraham. And that means a father of many nations. And we know that he's the father of who? The Jews, the Hebrews. Who else is he the father of?
The Arabs.
The Arabs. And is there anything going on between the Hebrews and the Arabs nowadays? Sibling rivalry.
Yeah.
On a big scale. Why? Well, because of the second name, Isaac. Isaac means laughing. And laughing why? Because Abraham and Sarah laughed when God said, as they were 100 years of age, I'm going to give you the heir to your fortune. Now, what would you do if you're 100 years of age and God blessed you with that gift? Carol, you're 83. In 17 years, you'll have another child. And you and Pete can then stay alive for the next 20 or 30 years to make sure the child is raised well. And then we'll see what happens after that. How about that? Anybody else want me to use them as an illustration this morning?
Nothing.
You can imagine. So the message comes to Sarah and she goes, right. Abraham works all day. He comes home. He's too tired and he falls asleep. He doesn't have the energy. Abraham laughs. Really, God? I mean, there's no little blue pill. So what are we going to do? So Isaac laughs. You see what God is doing here? He's saying, I'm the God of your fathers, and they weren't perfect. They were maybe a little old and kind of spent. They were people who laughed in my face. And even worse, they were cheats, thieves, liars, and deceivers. Yaakov, Jacob. There's a name that's not in here, though, because Jacob, the one who is described as liar, cheat, deceiver, was given a new name. And what was that?
Israel.
Israel. And what does Israel mean? Go ahead, cheat. Read the screen. What does it mean?
Struggles with God and wins.
A struggler with God who wins. And that's taken from the story where Jacob struggles with the angel and says, I won't let you go until you bless me. Okay, you can have a new name. I'm going to change it from cheat, liar, and deceiver to struggler with God who wins. Probably Jacob thought that was a great gift. But again, do you see what God's doing here? He's showing us that even in his relationship with human beings, we're not perfect, and yet his grace overcomes all of those shortcomings. So please, If you would ever hear anybody, especially a Christian brother or sister, say, well, there's no grace in the Old Testament. It's only in the New. The Old Testament is law. Just start spouting off these kinds of stories and say, don't you think that's grace? Moses, when he realized what God was doing, hid his face. Why? Because Moses knew that he was a flawed human being too. He didn't even want to look at God. It said that he was afraid. Have you ever been so afraid or maybe so cold that you shuddered on the inside? You shook. That's a really unnerving feeling. Well, that's what's being described here in this text. Moses was so afraid, he began to shake. He didn't know how to respond because he knew he wasn't going to be perfect, that he hadn't been perfect, and his name was going to be in that same line. God's a loving father. Look at these words. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, the loving father. But the Word is Jesus. How do these two connect? So what do we know from this passage? Our loving Father reaches out in love, unhindered by our faults and failures. If you came in here this morning and you've made a lot of mistakes, do this with me. Just take a big breath and relax. Because you're at home with your dad. We are who we are until we recognize the Father's love and yield ourselves to Him. I grew up thinking that God was there with a cosmic baseball bat, almost like that gopher game at the fair. If I pop my head up, and usually I'd be doing something wrong, I'd whack! That's not what God is like. God is a gracious, loving God. Now, we haven't learned enough. We have to talk about the life-giving Son. He's part of the Trinity, too. Read it with me. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. What does that mean? What if we took apart that sentence alone? For God, the great God who created the cosmos, so loved, the Greek word is agape or agape, it depends on where you went to shul. His love is sacrificial, sometimes suffering love. For God so loved the world, the cosmos, everything he made, that he gave over his only Son. I love it in French. Il a donné son fils unique. He gave his unique Son, his one-of-a-kind Son. This word doesn't mean begotten in the sense of giving birth to. It means the person who's able to inherit everything of God because he is very God. His only Son, so that whoever. So what does that limit us in this world too? Are there people who are left out of this invitation? No. That whoever believes in him, in other words, trusts enough to act, should not perish, won't be separated from God forever, won't be annihilated, but have eternal life. Look at what that means. The very life of God. People have been trying to get the life of God for our entire history. We've looked for fountains of youth. We try every day in our research around the globe to stop the shortening of our telomeres. We want to lengthen them so that our life will be long. We've tried forever. In ancient stories, to build towers to get to God so that we could live the life of God. And we failed miserably until Jesus came along. And then Jesus says, the Father's reaching out to you. The Father wants to give you his life. And we've said, no, Jesus. Well, not everybody. Some of us have said, no, Jesus. And some of us are still involved in knowing Jesus. And this is really important because in the Trinity, Jesus said, I and the Father are one. So what do we know from this part of the readings this morning? God selflessly gives his Son that you might escape your selfishness to have salvation. In other words, knowing the life of God comes by receiving salvation through his life-giving Son. You can have God's life. And there was silence. Is that not exciting enough for us? Studying for this sermon over the past 6 weeks, I kept coming back to that passage. I can have God's life. Why would I settle for anything less? Why would I want something else? I can have God's life. I can have his wisdom. I can have his power. I can have his ability to transform people and the world around me because he gives it to me. How? By his Holy Spirit. Look at this passage this morning. But you have received the Spirit of salvation, or of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and fellow heirs with Christ. You have received the Spirit of what? Adoption as sons. In other words, what the author is saying here is, in order to have the God life, you have to be able to inherit who God is. And the only one who can fully inherit who God is the person who completely allows God to embrace him or her and is able to embrace God as well. We have now a little adopted granddaughter. So on Friday night, when we were watching the boys play their football games, little Karis, who's about this tall, but has a personality about this tall, was telling us what she wanted to do. And she was acting on it as she was telling us. I go here. No, 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 come back, come back. Your mom and dad didn't say you can do that. I go there. No, 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 come back here. Here, let me pick you up. No, no, go there. What is she saying? I know you love me. I know you care for me. I know I can twist you around my little finger. I can get you to do anything I want you to do, almost. And when I'm 13, why does she have all those privileges? Because my son and daughter-in-law adopted her. Does she have any less privileges than the two guys who were out playing on the football field? She has nothing less. In fact, she has more. She doesn't even have to get hand-me-down clothes. Why? Because she's adopted. And guess what? She's not going to know she's adopted for a long, long time. And by then it will be completely in the DNA of her body and her mind that she belongs in this family. I want to tell you something. My oldest grandson has blonde hair and blue eyes. His brother, about 3 years younger, has brown hair and blue eyes. And our little adopted granddaughter, Karis, has brown hair and brown eyes. And guess who she looks like? Her Nana. So when I walk out on the field and say, hi, Karis, she goes. And when Nana walks on the field, she goes, ah. She knows. She's loved and completely embraced by Nana. She belongs. She doesn't know anything else. Have you ever stopped and thought, because God gives you his spirit, that's what he's trying to tell you? I've given you everything. Just hug me all day long. Live in my presence. Live my life. I'll give you all the power. I'll give you all the wisdom. I adopted you. Amen. I'm never going to let you go. Passage goes on to say a few more things. By whom we cry, which is another word of saying intercessory prayer. Abba, Father. I've told you the story, haven't I? Of flying to Israel. At 5 o'clock in the morning, the guy in front of me gets up and goes to say prayers. And his little daughter wakes up and realizes that Abba is not there. So she stands straight up at 5 o'clock in the morning and goes, Abba! And I can see him praying. It's just, Abba! And I can see him praying. Abba! Yes, yes, Rachel. Go to sleep again. I'll be right back. Back to bed. Her daddy was missing. Her sense of intimacy had been somehow, she felt separation. Abba, Father, your relationship with God by the Holy Spirit can be so close that you can be crying, Abba, Abba, all day long. Abba, thank you for the blessings. Abba, how am I going to fix this? Abba. He bears witness with our spirit. In other words, he convinces us that we are children of God. We're part of that full family. Heirs of God, to all of God's resources, through all of himself, and fellow heirs with Christ. We've been made co-inheritors with Jesus Christ, who suffered and died through crucifixion and was resurrected. We've become fellow heirs with Christ. That means we have eternal life, or again, the life of God. I was raised in a Pentecostal church. We would be dancing on the ceiling at this moment because we realize God's given us so much and he'll never take it back. That's the legacy of the Holy Spirit. Now, to just show the intimate relationship between Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, I take this passage about spiritual gifts. Now, there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of service, but the same Lord, and there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who empowers them all in every one. So, what have we learned this morning, especially about the Holy Spirit? That God's abiding Spirit bestows on and gives us access now to everything God, without reservation, forever. We can know the Trinity and have this life of God legacy within us. The Trinity. We can know and love God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, intimately and without reservation, now and forever.
Amen.
So I could have spent all morning giving you illustrations of the Trinity and lists of theological understandings of the Trinity from the early church fathers up until today. We could have played numerous YouTube videos on people trying to draw out or describe the Trinity. Even Carl Sagan is used on one of the videos. But what I want you to know is the relationship that you have. The knowledge of God, not just intellectual knowledge, but the experiential knowledge of God. He's calling you to draw close, closer than you've ever been before. And I'm hoping that I've upset you this morning. I'm hoping that I send you out of here so wanting more of God, more of that life of God, that you're never going to be happy again. You'll only live in nanoseconds of joy because you realize, okay, I got that little bit more. Okay, I got that little bit more. Okay, I got that little bit more. Remember, we are witnesses and custodians of the greatest mystery and beneficiaries of the most beautiful love story in cosmic history. Never forget, incarnate the word. Don't just hear it. Let's pray. Knowing you, Jesus, knowing you, it is the greatest thing. You're my all, you're the best. You're my joy, my righteousness. And I love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We love you. Thank you for making yourself known to us. Thank you for knowing us. Thank you for giving us the privilege of knowing you.
Yes, Lord.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
There's a beautiful song. It simply says, there is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do.
And there is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. And I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. Oh, there is none like you. No one else can touch my heart like you do. And I could search for all eternity long and find there is none like you. There's no one else, Lord. There's no one else, God, who can touch my heart. Who can touch my heart? There is none like you.
We're going to pray this morning together. And, you know, when you pray, this is that privilege of living God's life. So JR is going to lead us in prayer this morning. The white words are for him. The yellow words are for us. There's a part of the prayers of the people where we get to chime in. JR, lead us in prayer.
Father, we pray to you, our Lord God, thanking you for who you are, and that your love for us endures forever.
Thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit living in us, guiding and teaching us.
For all of us in our daily lives and work, in our struggles and successes.
For our families, friends, colleagues, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For our communities, especially Carlsbad, Oceanside, Vista, Encinitas, and Fallbrook, our nation and our world.
For all who work for justice, love, mercy, and walk humbly with you, Father.
For the just and the proper use of your creation, and those who care for our environment.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, war, and oppression, especially in Israel and Palestine.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and the unity of the Church of God at all times and in all places.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For the peace and the unity of the people of all races, cultures, colors, and ethnicities.
Help us repent and be reconciled to one another, healing histories of hurt and injustice.
For Archbishop Foley, Bishop Keith, Pastor Bill, Nima, Jeff, and Travis.
For all who minister, Jean, Memo, April, Paul, Francis, J.R., Carol, Ted, John, Dick, Claudia, Julie, Jim, Dick, and Paul.
We pray for our government leaders,
our President Joseph and First Lady Jill, and their staff, newly elected and incumbent members of Congress, and the justices of our Supreme Court.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation.
For our son Charlie and grandson Adam, for the safe completion of their hike with their troop this week.
For Norma, healing from a stroke.
For those who fought in war for us, Lord, as we remember this memorial day, freedoms we have in our country.
For our son, Tom.
School, Helen.
For families that will always have an empty place at the table.
For my sister, LaVon, turned 70 years old yesterday. Happy birthday. Continue to keep her in good health and happiness.
For all those graduating from high school and colleges, keep them all safe. Thank you for all their efforts.
Father, I thank you for Susanna and for Eden, that they are now home from the hospital with their respective families. Lord, I pray for continued healing in their lives.
Thank you for hearing us, Lord, and for all the blessings of this life. We exalt you, O God, our King.
Your mercy is great, and we praise your name forever and ever.
Lord, let your loving kindness be upon all who have died. as they find joy in your eternal kingdom.
They put their trust in you. Your love endures forever.
Grant our prayers, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Amen.
Now let us confess and receive God's forgiveness individually and together as we pray.
Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may again delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, Heavenly Father, in your great mercy, you promise forgiveness of sins to all who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to you. Lord, have mercy upon us, pardon us, and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and bring us to life everlasting through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
You are free to roam around the sanctuary for 1.5 minutes.
Lord Francis.
How many of you have turned one of these in already?
I have.
How many of you have not turned one of these in already? Okay, good. Keep your hand up. Okay, Klein, you said, okay. If you keep your hand up, Klein's going to give you one of these. How many of you are not going to raise your hand no matter how many times I ask a question? Can I just see your hand? All right. You need one of these. Cannot leave until you take one of these this morning, unless you're visiting from North Carolina. Okay, it's dangerous right now to wave to a friend across the aisle because we're going to think that you don't have one of these. Okay, all right. How many of you now have one of these and you desire to get one? All right, here's what I'm thinking. There should be at least 22 of you who needed one of these this morning. Because in the group that was here last week, from that group, we got 39, and we know that there were 22 other people. So there should be at least 22 of you who needed one of these this morning.
And we have your names.
Yes. We know JR says we have your name. We actually do have your name. Okay. You know what this is, right? This is your opportunity to become part of a really great team of people. As we open up from COVID, we need everybody to get back and start riding the horse again. And this gives you lots of different ways and opportunities to write in new ways or things that we forgot to be involved in the team here. So there are four teams. The I can minister, I'm a team player group of people who are interested in worship, people who are interested in mission, people who are interested in pastoral care, and the group of people that I particularly love, the boldly go people. Boldly go where no one has gone before. Okay, but we are going to plan to disrupt a few civilizations as we boldly go. Some of you will get that joke and others of you will not. Okay, I get it. All right, so there are lots of ways that you can be a part, but I want to emphasize something this morning. You might be saying, you know, I can't lead the church softball team. I can't be the captain of the hockey team. I can't slam dunk anymore. But what I can do is pray. And guess what? There's a verse for you in scripture. Rejoice always, pray constantly, give thanks in every circumstance, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus concerning you. Have you ever been reading scripture and suddenly something jumps out at you? I mean, it's just there for... It happened again. Pray constantly. So you may not know what specifically you'd like to do in here, but I'm going to ask some of you who maybe didn't sign up to just maybe circle worship team and then on the under other, write, I will pray on this team. Or circle mission team and under other, I will pray on this team. Or pastoral care team under other, I will pray on this team. Or boldly go in this big box, write, I will pray. In big letters. And you might be thinking, well, praying doesn't do all that much, does it really? You know, it's the foundation to everything that we're doing here. You'll be a part of probably the most transformative part of the teams if you become a prayer. So I'm going to keep flogging this for 2 more weeks. Because I want everybody to be part of the team. Everybody. So sign up, put prayer on there, and become a part of Team 100%. A prayer is a player, is what I'm telling you this morning. Use those areas, sign up, be a team player, and be a prayer, okay? And when you come up this morning, as you fill this in, as you come up for communion, just turn to the right and there's a basket. You can put your filled out brochure and make sure to put your name and contact information on it. You can put your brochure there and take one of the crosses right next to it. And our guests from North Carolina, please take a cross this morning and don't worry about this. Okay, great. All right, plastic and aluminum beverage containers are ministry money. Bring them next week, Dick's gonna be back. And this is the name of our new philosophy course that we'll be experiencing on Tuesday nights. The first two dates are the 8th and the 15th, 6:30 p.m. Come to PB and R is not another kind of sandwich, it's Pastor Bill and Rose's. So come and join us at 6:30. And the name of the course is called, What Were You Thinking? Isn't that a good, that's a good name for a philosophy course. And notice, Popeye, Homer Simpson, James Dean, and I think, is it Clint Eastwood? Yeah, Clint Eastwood, are among those other philosophers. Yeah, they really do have something to say. Now, Rose, you have to come up here. Because I told everybody at staff meeting this week that we can no longer have people talking without being close to the guy with the microphone.
Okay, and this is for our Zoom folks. If you want to eat with us, come between 6:15, 6:30, we will eat till 7. But the study will start at 7. Now, we said earlier that I had many people say, I'm not off work, so I can't get there at 4:35. So we backed it up so more of you can come. Now, you may say, I don't want to study. Well, I have a nice garden with some patio tables. You can go outside. You can finish eating. You can talk among yourself. Bring some cards. Play some games. The rest of us will be inside studying. But please come. Okay, so you don't have to think about these people. Just come and be together. We've been closed up for COVID. We want to be together.
Yes.
So thank you. And Zoom people, check emails because everything's on there.
What do you mean cards and games? Why did we get all that mulch? All right. So if you come and you want to be part of the philosophy part, warning, some thinking will be required. JR.
Thank you. We're starting something new. Okay,
I'll get a mic. Yep, get a mic. This is for those of you who are online who can't hear us unless we use a microphone. There we go.
We're going to start something new. And as of right now, there's four of us, prayer ministers, myself, Ann, Allie, and Kevin. We need more. And some of you are Order of St. Luke, have been prayer ministers before. Please get with Ann or Allie, and we will get this going. One of the other things, you'll see I'm holding a box. When you come in the morning, find the box if you need prayer. And write your prayer down, fold it, it's in the back. My wife is telling me, tell them it's in the back. I will be carrying it around. It'll be on the back, and there's paper and there's pens. Write down your prayer, put it in the box. During this time, the box will be brought up, put it on the altar, and we'll pray for it, not opening it up. Just Father Bill will just pray over it real quick. And then after service, prayer ministers will take it. We will read all the prayers and pray over them. If you want your prayers to go to Gene, to go on our prayer list, please annotate that down on there. So then the whole congregation is praying specifically for that need. But prayer is something everybody in this church can do. Mm-hmm. To the oldest, to the youngest, mm-hmm. we can all pray. Yeah. Yeah. And it takes no effort. It's something God gave every one of us. It's the one gift every one of us has, yes. is prayer. Thank you.
About ready to receive this morning's tithes, offerings, and almsgiving. And we're going to pass the plate. We know now that we don't have any kind of indication that through transfer on offering plates, people have gotten sick. So we're going to pass the plate this morning. And I want to thank you so much for your generosity. We're able to do all of these things up on the screen because of what you give. Let's stand as we pray. Lord, I offer myself again to you, all that I am and have. I owe to you in love and generosity. You give me joy, redeem me, save me, and by your tender mercy, give me your many blessings. Lord, receive me, my gratitude, and my offerings with thanks. Amen. Thank you. Stand together and sing the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above me, heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Father, we thank you for these gifts. Pray that you'll bless each gift and each giver. Multiply these gifts so that we can do all that you've called us to do. In Jesus' name we pray. All said,
amen. Amen.
If you're joining us this morning for communion, I want to invite you all to be a part of the I want to invite you all to be a part of communion. If you know Christ as your Savior and Lord, I encourage you to do that. But if you will stand, we're going to do the Athanasian Creed this morning, which is the creed that most of us think about as the Trinitarian Creed. So on Trinity Sunday, we confess our faith in God by the Creed of Athanasius, which reminds us of the truths concerning the one true God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and of the incarnation of the Son, Jesus Christ, who saves us. And that knowing this God and these truths protects us from dangerous heresy and leads us to eternal life. And just one other word, when we say the word Catholic, we mean all Christians. So you'll see Christians in brackets. So I will say the words in white if you will confess the words in yellow. Whoever would be saved needs before all things to hold fast the Catholic faith, which faith except a person keep whole and undefiled. Without doubt, he or she will perish eternally. Now the Catholic faith is this, that we worship one God in Trinity and the Trinity in unity, neither confusing the persons nor dividing the substance. For there is one person of the Father, another of the Son, and another of the Holy Spirit. But the Godhead of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit is all one, the glory equal and the majesty co-eternal. Such as the Father is, such is the Son, and such is the Holy Spirit. The Father uncreated, the Son uncreated, the Holy Spirit uncreated. The Father infinite, the Son infinite, the Holy Ghost infinite. The Father eternal, the Son eternal, and the Holy Ghost eternal. Yet there are not three eternals, but one eternal. As also there are not three uncreated, nor three infinities, but one infinite and one uncreated, so likewise the Father is almighty, the Son almighty, the Holy Spirit almighty. And yet there is not three almighties, but one almighty. So the Father is God, the Son God, and the Holy Spirit God. And yet there are not three gods, but one God. So the Father is Lord, the Son Lord, the Holy Spirit Lord. And yet there are not three lords, but one Lord. Like as we are compelled by the Christian to confess each person by himself to be both God and Lord, so we are forbidden by the Catholic religion to speak of three gods or three lords. The Father is made of none, nor created, nor begotten. The Son is of the Father alone, not made, nor created, but begotten. The Holy Spirit is of the Father, the Son not made, nor created, nor begotten, but proceeding. There is therefore one Father, not three fathers, one Son, not three sons, one Holy Spirit, not three Holy Spirits. And in this Trinity, there is no before or after, the greater or less. But all three persons are co-eternal together and co-equal. So that in all ways, as is aforesaid, both the Trinity is to be worshipped in unity and unity in Trinity. Therefore, he would say, let him think of the Trinity. Furthermore, it is necessary to eternal salvation that he also believe faithfully the incarnation of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, the right faith is that we believe and confess that our Lord Jesus Christ, the Son of God, is both God and man. He is God, the substance of the Father, begotten before the words, and the substance of his mother, born in the world. Perfect God, perfect man, reasoning soul and human flesh subsiding, equal to the Father as touching his Godhead, less than the Father as touching his manhood, who although he be God and man, yet he is not two, but one Christ. One, however, not by conversion of Godhead into flesh, but by taking of manhood into God, one altogether, not by confusion of substance, but by unity of person. For as reasoning soul and flesh is one man, so God and man is one Christ, who suffered for our salvation, descended into hell, rose again from the dead, ascended into heaven, sat down at the right hand of the Father, from whence he shall come to judge the living and the dead, at whose coming all men and women must rise again with their bodies and shall give account of their own deeds. And they who have done evil into eternal fire. This is the Catholic faith, which except each man and each woman do faithfully and steadfastly believe, he or she cannot be saved. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is just and right, so to do.
It is right, and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord. In you we live and move and have our being. You are the great I am, and you are for us. You give us your image, and we find our identity in you. You are life and breath and everything else. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and all the company of heaven who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Himself and made once for all time a perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. He instituted this remembrance, his passion and death, which he commanded us to continue until he comes again. So now, Father, we offer this bread and this wine, asking that you bless and sanctify it with your word and Holy Spirit, that it may be for your people both the body and blood of Jesus Christ, your Son. On the night that he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord and Heavenly Father, with this holy gift of bread and wine, we celebrate the memorial instituted by your beloved Son. Remembering his passion and death, his resurrection and ascension, and his promise to come again, Grant that by his merits and death and through faith in his blood, we and your whole church may receive forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of his passion, making us one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. And here we offer to you again this morning ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a living sacrifice through Jesus Christ, our Lord. For by him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, both now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Sins and the sins of the world.
Grant us your peace.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. So take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Just let me say a word to all of you this morning. You are all welcome to come and participate this morning. If you're not used to our form of doing things, just put your left hand down first, your right hand over it. I'll give you a wafer, and then you can dip it in the wine this morning and take communion with us. God bless you as you do.
Also, we have prayer ministers in the back.
Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for the grace of worshiping together this morning, assembling us in this most holy way, and assuring us of your love, that we are identified as living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, help us act in mission for those who need to grow their faith in you. Launch us into the world to love and serve you as joyful witnesses of Christ our Lord, in the peace and presence and power of the Holy Spirit. Let us share Jesus and do practical works of compassionate love, mercy, and service to bring honor and glory to your name and healing, help, and hope to all we meet, both now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you peace. And may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Now let's sing the last two verses of Holy, Holy, Holy as we process into the mission field. God bless you.
Way to connect with the world is by saying hello. How are you doing? Let us connect with the world, proclaiming from all around us that everyone can have faith in God who loves us and truly knows Jesus and the peace and the presence of the power of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah! Hallelujah!
In the name of Christ we go. Hallelujah! 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 Hallelujah.